Because unfortunately I did not complete my BSc physics and was sitting at home doing nothing. At that time, my father said, why don't you join the RL Law College, Belgaum, which has an intermediate LLB course of 2 years, which means that as against a 3-year course, I would be able to do it in 2 years, and I need not do my, need not graduate. So I said, very well. And it was a wonderful time in Belgaum, one of the happiest years of my life, because we didn't have to attend classes, and we had to learn only from the dukis or the jabwalas, and you would get a pass. So when I went back, I was very reluctant to practice law, but my father made me sit by my side and said that watch as to how cases are argued. But the moment he started addressing the judge and concentrating on the judges, I would get up and go away. But finally, I had to put my nose to the grindstone. And I have to say, it is merely because of my father I'm here today, and what I'm today is due to him. It was, I think, Isaac Newton who said that if I seen further than others, it is because I stood on the shoulders of giants. To me, my father was a giant, but he could not believe it. He was a very humble person, and he would be shocked if he was told by somebody that you are a giant. But then, of course, he made me work very hard. And of course, once you started earning some money, then there is no question of your not continuing to practice law to the best of your ability. I was a motor vehicles lawyer in the beginning. From the 1960s, I used to come to the Supreme Court to argue cases on my own, because the motor vehicles where was a very paying field, so far as the motor vehicles was concerned. But take it from me, many of the very important cases have been decided under the Motor Vehicles Act in regard to constitutional cases as well, company cases and so on. Therefore, here I am, and of course, I would say that if you want to be a good lawyer, you have to work very, very hard indeed. And I didn't believe that at this age also, I had to be work so hard, and I'm practically a slave. But I don't know, perhaps it's worth it. Thank you.
I request Mr. Vikas Singh, President of Supreme Court Bar Association, to deliver his presidential address.
My Lord, the Chief Justice of India, Honorable Judges of this Court, Justice S.C. Agarwal, who's present here, and he was associated with Mr. D.P. Singh, which I'll talk about later. My learned Attorney General for India, other distinguished guests and colleagues. We are assembled here today to unveil the portraits of some of the legends of our profession. And I'd like to speak a couple of words regarding each one of them. Normally, I don't like to read when I speak, but these are such legends that I don't want to miss out on anything. So I thought I'll pen down things and then try and... Mr. Nambyar, known as Barrister M.K. Nambyar, hailed from Chengamanad village in Kerala. Mr. Nambyar belonged to a family of landlords. After graduating from Mangalore, Mr. Nambyar took his law degree from Madras Law College and enrolled as a lawyer in Mangalore in 1924. He went to England out of sheer compulsion to prepare and defend some family litigation of his joint family. Not only Mr. Nambyar won the litigation, but also studied and obtained his LLM degree in constitutional and administrative law from the University of London, stood first and won many prizes, including a gramophone. He appeared in 1933 in the Privy Council instructing Senior Counsel Subba Rao, and appeared along with him in the case of 1933 Privy Council. Upon return to India, he practiced in Mangalore for about 10 years. during which time he was public prosecutor and government pleader. He then shifted to Madras. Mr. Nambyar made his mark as a constitutional lawyer by his appearance and arguments in landmark judgment of Gopalan versus State of Madras under Article 21. On account of Mr. Nambyar's persuasive advocacy, Section 14 of the Preventive Detention Act was struck down as unconstitutional on the ground that it contravened the provisions of Article 22.5. Kania CJ, in his judgment in Gopalan, paid well-deserved tribute to Mr. Nambyar in these words: "The court is indebted to the learned counsel for the applicant, that is Mr. Nambyar, and the Attorney General for their assistance in interpreting the true meaning of the relevant clauses of the Constitution." Mr. Nambyar's most significant contribution in the field of constitutional and fundamental right was his argument in Golaknath that the amending power under 368 is not absolute but subject to certain implied limitation. It is remarkable that the very argument advanced by him in Gopalan as well as in Golaknath regarding implied limitation was subsequently accepted by the apex court in Kesavanand Bharti. Mr. Nambyar passed away on 18 December 75, few months after the June 75 emergency was foisted on the country. He was disturbed by the imposition of emergency and the malafide detention of reputable political leaders and persons. On account of his weak health, he could not lead an active campaign. In the full court reference held by the Supreme Court on passing of Mr. Nambyar, the Chief Justice of India had said, "Mr. Nambyar, by nature of a scholastic bent of mind, he would make intensive preparation of cases before they would appear in court. He would get to roots and principles of law. He would make an incisive study on case law. The result of his industry was apparent when he presented." Mr. Narende, the Attorney General, in full court reference struck a touching personal note. He said, "Nambyar had a slight stoop while he was on his legs and he looked more like an absent-minded professor than the great lawyer and advocate that he was. This stoop was perhaps due to the burden of his intellect before that bore than his physical ability, disability. As a man, Nambyar was an embodiment of modesty, humility, kindness, courtesy in all aspects of life. He had a passionate concern for the junior and his encouragement of junior was proverbial." This is what Mr. Nirend, senior advocate Mr. Venugopal, who is here today, on his felicitation by the Bar Council of India for being appointed as Attorney General, spoke at length about his professional journey and calling it long and arduous, and credited his father and mentor for wherever he is today. Mr. Nambyar passed away after a brief illness in Madras on 18 December. Today, we in the Supreme Court are proud to acknowledge that his legacy continues in his son being the Attorney General, and what a proud father he would be wherever he is with this. Not only that, his grandson also is a very eminent senior advocate in Krishnan Venugopal. So what an illustrious family. Mr. Prabha Shanker Mishra was a great jurist, a great administrator, and a real gentleman. Mr. Mishra was born in 1936, a master of science from Patna University who did his bachelor's in law from the same university. Justice Mishra was known for his legal acumen all through his professional service. Justice Mishra inherited law as a legacy from his father, who was a reputed advocate of the District Court of Chhapra, Bihar. Enrolled as an advocate in 1960, he was appointed judge of the Patna High Court and later got transferred to the Madras High Court in 1990. He was made Chief Justice of Andhra Pradesh in May 95 and continued till October 97, after which he was posted as Chief Justice of Calcutta. A few weeks before retirement, Justice Mishra submitted his resignation and established himself as a reputed constitutional lawyer. After tendering his resignation from the post of Chief Justice, Justice Mishra told BBC, "The three judges appointed to the Supreme Court were his junior. He criticized the way judges were appointed to the highest court." Mr. Mishra represented government as special public prosecutor in important cases and began his career as an advocate. And after an interlude of about 16 years, when crossed over to the bench and served as judge and chief justice in different high court, he came back to the legal profession and worked as a lawyer till the end of his life. Apart from being a lawyer and a judge, he was associated with a number of social and cultural activities. He was editor of the well-known magazine Aram Para and wrote regular columns for the daily Indian Nation. As a judge of the Patna High Court, Madras High Court, Chief Justice Andhra Pradesh and Chief Justice Calcutta, Justice Mishra delivered large number of judgments and he was required to interpret law such as Section 6 of the Delhi Special Police Establishment Act, Section 25F, 25FF of the ID Act and various entries of the Constitution. These judgments reflect his belief in justice tempered with mercy. During his tenure at the bar of Patna High Court, Justice Mr. Mishra was one of the most sought after lawyers and he commanded perhaps the largest number of briefs conducting cases of all disciplines and all matters. His forte, however, was constitutional law. One of his contributions to the profession of law needs special mention. Before his appointment as a judge, his office at Patna produced a last crop of junior who in due course developed well into well-known lawyers at different branches of law, greatly enriching the Patna High Court. He maintained interpersonal relations within family, colleagues and society in general, and as such a standard that is remembered by survivors. He was a worthy son, ideal husband, a father and a good friend. He had wide knowledge of Vedas, Quran, Bible, apart from various branches of law, especially the Constitution of India. He passed away on 1st July 2012 at the age of 76. His son Manu Mishra is a practicing lawyer with us and we are happy that his legacy continues in this court. Mr. S.V. Shankar Vinayak Gupte graduated from Bombay in 1925 and then completed his LLB degree in 29 from Government Law College, Bombay, enrolled as advocate in 29. He became chairman advisor of Bombay Municipal Workers Union and Central Government Non-Gazetted Staff Association. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar solicited his assistance of Mr. Gupte in preparing the Hindu Court Bill under the guidance of Mr. B.N. Rao, the then judge of the International Court of Justice. He played an important role as a member of the Committee on Hindu Court Bill. His jurist work as author of Hindu Law in British India, Hindu Law Marriage, Hindu Law Succession, Hindu Law of Adoption, Minority are well known. He was also editor of the Indian Law Reporter, Bombay series for 10 years. Mr. Gupte was appointed additional Solicitor General from 63 to 64, later became the third Solicitor General from 64 to 67, and he was the fourth Attorney General from 77 to 79. He became Vice President Law Asia and attended international conference at Japan. Mr. Gupte was known for his strong views on the question of transfer of judges. His devotion to the legal profession was wholehearted and complete. He would never accept more than two SLPs if they were in different courts, and if in the same court, not more than four. He disliked accepting two. His address, in an address which he delivered before the Bombay High Court Appellate Side Bar when he was made an honorary member of that association in 63, Mr. Gupte, while ASG, said, "I must say at once that I have received from members young and old love and affection I had never dreamt of. Not that I do not believe that fellow lawyers are not capable of giving love and affection. It is only that I have always regarded myself as a cold, cynical and somewhat brutal person." Mr. Gupte passed away on 7th May 85 at the age of 82. During his lifetime, his portrait was unveiled at the Bombay High Court Bar Library by Justice Madon, the then Chief Justice of the Bombay High Court. Today we are proud to have his portrait here. Justice G.C. Bharuka completed law from Ranchi and was enrolled as an advocate in 68. In 84, Justice Bharuka was designated a senior advocate by the Patna High Court. In 90, he was appointed a permanent judge of Patna. In 94, Justice Bharuka was transferred to Karnataka, wherein during his term, he also was acting Chief Justice. Justice Bharuka was a revolutionary, and his passion and dedication towards implementation of information technology in the Indian courts led him to be the first judge to initiate the process of court computerization in Patna. On transfer to Karnataka High Court, he undertook to introduce ICT in the entire judiciary of state of Karnataka. There was complete automation from filing of a case to grant of a certified copy. Through website, cause lists of the high courts and district courts were made available online for the first time in the country. While at Karnataka High Court as a sitting judge, Justice Bharuka undertook several doctoral research in the field of information and technology as part of the judicial reforms and completed PhD from the National School of Law. In 2004, accepting the Karnataka system as role model, the Union Cabinet, on the recommendation of the Honorable Chief Justice of India, formed an e-committee appointing Justice Bharuka as its chairman for formulating a national policy and action plan for Information and Communication Technology, Enablement of the Indian Judiciary and Suggest Measures for Management Related Changes. In August 2005, he submitted a national policy and action plan to the Chief Justice of India. The project for ICT enablement of the judiciary envisioned by him was launched by the Honorable Prime Minister of 5/10/2005. He was editor of 2007 edition of Mullah's Partnership Act, 2007 edition of Mullah's Sale of Goods Act, editor of 10th edition of Mullah's Transfer of Property Act. He contributed a chapter on corruption in justice delivery system in the book Fighting Corruption, The Way Forward. He also contributed a chapter on access to justice in the book Judicial Reforms in India. He was a regular faculty in the National Judicial Academy, Bhopal, Chanakya, Patna. He was engaged as an external consultant by the Asian Development Bank. He was also engaged in Deloitte India as an external consultant for improvement of judicial system, Kenya, through e-governance in 2008 and 9. In 13-14, World Bank engaged him in their project for studying land governance in India. We are again proud to unveil his portrait today. Mr. Dilkishore Prasad Singh, MA Bar at Law, Senior Advocate, ex-MP, Rajya Sabha Bihar, was born in 4th April 1931. I share a very special bond with Mr. Singh because when I started my practice, I joined his chamber. Of course, by that time he was not there, but I had the advantage and the privilege of working with his son and his daughter. Mr. D.P. Singh completed law from Lincoln's Inn, London, and started practicing in Patna under late Babu Baldev Sahai, grandfather of Justice Naveen Sinha, and Shri Baldev Prasad Singh, father of Justice N.P. Singh. He shifted his practice to Supreme Court in 56 and passed the AOR examination. He founded Ramamurthy & Company along with Ramamurthy, Mr. M.K. Ramamurthy, late Mr. R.K. Garg and Honorable Justice S.C. Agarwal. That company, Mr. Agarwal, is the only surviving member. We are pleased to have you, sir, with us today. He was designated as a senior advocate of the Supreme Court on 8/5/72 and practiced till his death. As a senior advocate, he appeared in several leading cases, including the cases of Keshwanand Bharati, Golaknath, DIR case, Indira Nehru Gandhi, Muthamma, amongst many others. He was also a member of the Raj Sabha between 71-78. He was closely associated with doyens of the bar, both as an instructing lawyer and then as an adversary. In the profession, some of his juniors have been designated seniors by the Supreme Court, namely Shri R.K. Jain, Mr. Salman Khurshid, Mr. Rajiv Datta, Mr. Amarin Sharan. In politics, several of his juniors have become ministers of the Union government, namely Salman Khurshid, Margaret Alva, Eduardo Filero, and one amongst them, Shri Tarun Gogoi, has been Chief Minister of Assam. As an eminent lawyer and respected politician, he enjoyed great respect among his colleagues and peers. His rich legacy is carried on in the Supreme Court by his son Gopal and daughter Vimla and grandson Shivam. Mr. Singh passed away on 19 March 88. Today, we in the Supreme Court are proud to honor his legacy by unveiling his portrait. Mr. Pavani Parameshwara Rao was born in Mogalaichara village in a Prakasam district of AP. He completed his BA from VR College, Nellore, Andhra, and his LLB, LLM from Osmania University, Hyderabad. Mr. Rao started his career teaching law in the University of Delhi in 61. He was enrolled as an advocate by the Bar Council of Delhi in 67 and thereafter practiced in the Supreme Court. He was a chamber junior of Mr. N.C. Chatterjee, senior advocate and parliamentarian. Thereafter, when Mr. N.C. Chatterjee left for Calcutta due to his ailing health in 67, he joined the chambers of his former teacher, Mr. Raja Vasudev Pillai, senior advocate. During the time, he assisted several leading lawyers of the time, namely like Mr. Sirvai, Mr. Sitalwar, Mr. Daftari, Mr. Chatterjee, Mr. Dupte, Mr. Sen, Mr. Niramde. In 69, he became an advocate on record. He was advocate record for the state of Andhra, junior standing counsel for the central government before he was designated senior by the Supreme Court in 76. He was elected president of the Supreme Court Bar Association in 1991, and in 2006, he was awarded the Padma Bhushan. In 4th March 10, he was awarded the LLD. In recognition of his eminence and contribution to the cause of public interest. He was author of various chapters in books like Constitution of India, Supreme Court But Not Infallible, Political Reforms, and author of book Reclaiming the Vision Challenges of Indian Constitutional Law and Governance. He was widely considered a doyen of constitutional law and had argued a number of landmark cases before Supreme Court, appeared in several other leading cases involving interpretation of the Constitution. He successfully fought against capitation fee in the Unni Krishnan case and the privilege of members of parliament in the P.B. Narasimha Rao case. Mr. Rao was an outstanding, dynamic advocate, uniformly respected by the bench and the bar, not only in the Supreme Court, but in the legal fraternity in India and abroad. With landmark cases like Babri Masjid demolition, 2G spectrum in his kitty, Mr. Rao was considered as the constitutional law expert, and even judges could not ignore his interpretation. Mr. Rao loved reading Shakespearean plays, Macbeth being his favorite. He also loved reading works of R.K. Narayan, K.P.S. Menon, Raja Rao and the likes. Mr. Rao used to spend his time reading biographies and travelogues during his free hours. Mr. Rao used to spend about 45 minutes swimming every day. Mr. Rao used to give advice to young lawyer graduates and law students to give to the society more than what they receive, a practice that he adopted in his hospitality to the fullest. Mr. Rao's chamber was known as a fertile ground for producing eminent jurists such as Mr. Ganguly and Mr. Venkatramani. Mr. Rao passed away on 11 September 17 at the age of 84 and is survived by his son Praveen and his daughter-in-law Mahalakshmi, who recently donated a bus to the Supreme Court Bar Association in the memory of Mr. Rao for the lawyers to travel from Supreme Court to the Delhi High Court, NGT, etc. Today we are again having a proud moment to unveil his photographic leave. Mr. Krishnamani, he completed his BSc in Geology from Presidency College, Madras, and then pursued law from Madras Law College and enrolled as an advocate in 71. He worked as a junior of late Mr. Nambyar and of Mr. K.K. Venugopal between 71 to 77. In 77, he set up his practice as an independent lawyer. He started his practice in Madras and had a wide range of work in different fields of law and was prominent as a young lawyer from 71 to 81 in Madras. He specialized in writs and was known as a writ-a-day lawyer, since he was appearing in at least one new writ petition every day. In 1981, he shifted his practice to Delhi to practice in Supreme Court. He appeared in several important cases which were widely reported. He has appeared in almost all high courts located in different states in India. He has appeared for the Union Bank of India, different state governments, statutory authorities, and nationalized bank before Supreme Court. He appeared before Justice Verma Commission and Justice Jain Commission in the Rajiv Gandhi assassination on behalf of certain leaders of the Congress Party. He appeared for the Tamil Nadu government before Justice Nag Commission and Justice Devendra Gupta Commission in connection with the ban on LTTE. He was also senior standing counsel for the Delhi government, Delhi Development Authority, and he has been regularly appearing as senior advocate from the Bar Council of India from Supreme Court. He was also appeared in the Ram Janmabhoomi case in the Allahabad High Court, full bench on the behalf of the Hindus. He had a brief political career from 69 to 75. He joined the Indian National Congress in 69. He became the General Secretary of Law College Students Union in the Madras Law College. Later, he became Vice President of the Youth Congress in Madras. In 75, he left politics and plunged into spirituality, education, social work, besides continuing in the legal profession. He was Vice President of the Supreme Court Bar 4 times, President of the Supreme Court Bar several times, and President of the Delhi Tamil Sangam several times, representing over 1.2 million Tamils in Delhi. He was one of the founder members of the Veda Parishad. He was the General Secretary of Sanatan Sangeet Sanskriti and Treasurer of Sardar Patel Society. He received the National Law Day Award for Excellence in Civil Cases in 98. He was given the prestigious Seva Ratna Award by the Centenarian Trust in 2005. He was given Secular India Harmony Award in 2005, and he was awarded the Shresht Kala Pracharak Award by Ganesh Natyale and Ganesh Fine Arts Society in 2009. He was awarded Padma Shri in the field of public affairs by the Government of India in 2016. Recognizing his contribution in the field of law, the North Orissa University Baripeda conferred him the degree of Doctors of Law. He was author of books like Bhaj Govindan, Godly Men and Their Godly Words, Shankarara, The Revolutionary, Essence of Gita, Aryan Dravid Myth from Doubt to Certainty, Sigh on Himself, and How Can You Miss the Omnipresent. Mr. Krishnamani passed away on 15 February 2017 in Bengaluru, and he had a very rare insight on his death, because he recorded a video couple of days before his death where he could feel that very soon he is going to die, and he in that video expressed what he felt, what his feelings being so close to death, which is a very rare thing, and that kind of thing can happen only with somebody who has saintly characters. So friends, we are today at a very important moment of this, of the history of this court, that we are having the I think I missed out Mr. Mohta. Justice Mohta. I'm so sorry. Justice Mohta was born on 4th December 55 in Akola, Maharashtra, and graduated from DAV College, Kanpur. Thereafter, in 58, he completed his LLB from Nagpur and went on to practice law in the Bombay High Court. Justice Mohta was a beloved member of the bar, and in 1974 was elected as Vice President of the Bar Council of Maharashtra. Justice Mohta served as a judge of the Bombay High Court for a period of 15 years from 79 to 94, and thereafter was appointed as Chief Justice of Orissa High Court. He also recommended the name of the current Chief Justice of India, Justice Dipak Misra, as a judge. Justice Mohta has represented India at SAARC Law Conference held in Sri Lanka, Pakistan, Bhutan, and was also a member of the Committee for Implementing Legal Aid Schemes formed by the Government of India. He was appointed as chairman of a committee by Government of India to probe into the accident of an AI aircraft in Aurangabad. Upon retirement, he returned private practice and until his demise remained active as practice in a senior member of the Supreme Court. Very many times I used to have lunch with him in this lunch room that we have at the first floor. He wrote articles on various subjects in national and international journals and authored two books on arbitration and conciliation trademarks. Justice Mohta breathed his last on 3rd July 18 at his birthplace, Akola, Maharashtra. Today, we in the Supreme Court are proud on unveiling his portrait, which we will be placing at some prominent place. So this is, friends, a very great moment for us. And today, while I was coming here from the court, Justice Mishra's court was sitting late today. Mr. Ashok Desai rang me and he said that probably, in his view, the portrait of Mr. Nambyar and Mr. S.V. Gupte had been unveiled by Justice Venkat Chaliya when he was Chief Justice of India. But in our records, it was not there, so we decided to have this portrait unveiling. Probably the portrait also is not available. But for legends like these, I have no hesitation in saying that we can unveil their portraits again and again, because these are doyens of the bar and they inspire us, they inspire the future generation of the legal profession, and seeing them around us on a daily basis will help the legal profession in a very big way. Thank you, friends.
I request Hon’ble Mr. Justice Dipak Misra, Hon’ble the Chief Justice of India, to kindly deliver his address.
My esteemed brother judges, Justice Agrawal, formerly a judge of this court, Mr. K.K. Venugopal, Honorable Attorney General for India, Mr. Vikas Singh, President SCBA, Mr. Parjoshi, Vice President, Mr. Vikrant Yadav, the Honorary Secretary, the members of the bar, friends from the electronic and print media, ladies and gentlemen. The entire biography has been read to you one after the other. But now I will pick up from the last sentence Mr. Vikas Singh said, that he was told by Mr. Desai that the portraits of Mr. Nambyar and Mr. Gupte had already been unveiled by former Chief Justice of India. And he said there is no difficulty in unveiling another one. I would like to say there are three distinct concepts when you unveil a portrait. First of all, you must understand there is a distinction between a photograph, a portrait, and a video recording. Sometimes when you look at a photograph, you may feel possibly the man looks at you or is not looking at you. But when you look at the portrait, a real portrait, you will find the man is possibly gazing at you. And when you see a video recording of the man, you will notice possibly is absolutely indifferent towards you. So now the difference between portrait, photograph and video recording, I think if that was a portrait and this is a portrait, if that was a photograph, this is a photograph, I don't know. But twice done is well done. Second, once in a particular unveiling of a portrait of a father, son was invited. He was in the audience. The organizers asked him to come and speak few words. And he spoke, contrived, quote unquote, three lines. "Ladies and gentlemen, the portrait you have unveiled today belongs to my father. I can say with pride that he was my father. That apart, he had also fathered many young persons by giving fatherly affection, advice. I presume, and I am entitled to, that Mr. Venugopal must be extremely delighted to be present when his father's portrait is unveiled, forgetting in the past whether it had been unveiled or not. With the passage of time, portraits are to be unveiled from time to time. Why not? It depends. Another aspect I like to highlight, the portrait has a value. I assume there was no photograph or photography at the time of the Romans and the Greeks, but we still have the portraits of Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, Julius Caesar, Augustus Caesar, name many. That helps us to understand and sometimes to wonder how this man looked. Was he a carpenter? Did he write this book? Did he teach Alexander? So many concepts come to your mind. And therefore, history, with pride and happiness, always desired to have portraits. And today, the Supreme Court Bar Association has done an excellent duty, albeit an institutional duty, by unveiling the portraits of these legends, so that the posterity can know these are the legends, and they may look at them, how they looked, and when they argued in court, how they might have argued. This is in the realm of conceptual imagination. So anyone who is present here, they must have gone conceptually imaginative. I am including you. I have not seen most of them, but I have seen, Mr. Bikas Singh has already told, Justice Mohta, Chief Justice of Orissa High Court, when he arrived sometime in the 1994, and he was a very different kind of man. He understood his law, and yet he was very strict in his approach. I will not say more about him. I have to speak somewhere else afterwards, not today. Justice Bharuka had come to Madhya Pradesh at Jabalpur while he was a member of the E-Committee, and he was so articulate about the whole project I asked him, "Sir, how could you speak like this about a dry subject?" He only said, and I remember, "It's my passion." Possibly he had appeared before me on 2-3 occasions, that's different. But the passion in the man as far as the e-court management and whatever he was part of the committee was really, really praiseworthy. Mr. P.P. Rao had argued many matters before us. I found him very calm, poised, but very forceful lawyer. And he always made propositional arguments. Anyone who will read his written notes or submissions, they can go to his chamber and ask the daughter-in-law, as he's practicing here, "Please give us the written notes that deserves publication, how a lawyer crafts his propositions to impress the court." And sometimes when you are against him, he doesn't really lose his control. He tries to convince you, and sometimes I must admit, you are compelled to lend your ears to him, and eventually you may be convinced or may not be. All others, like Mr. Nambyar, I have heard so many stories about him. When I say stories, I mean the glorious incidents attached to him. Mr. Gupte and Mr. D.P. Singh and P.S. Mishra. P.S. Mishra, I never personally interacted, though I was Chief Justice of Patna for 5 months. Possibly during that time he did not go to Patna, and even if he had gone, I didn't have the opportunity to meet him, and here there was no occasion. But he was absolutely a strong man in his own rights. When you talk of, you are calling about, I must say about Krishnamani, he was here the other day. You must also note that all of us were here. What Mr. Bikash Singh says is very impressive. He knew the death was coming, but still he had the courage to have a video recording what